Hey, we'd like to say it's good to see everybody here tonight. Thank you for being with us. Glad to have you here. Want you to pray for our service tonight. Pray that God will just have his way in it. Want you to remember our prayer request. Remember Miss Bonnie, she's still at home not feeling good. Want you to pray for her. Pray for Brother Jeremy. Brother Larry asked prayer for him this morning. We want you to remember him and pray that God will just work in his life. I want you to remember our church. Amen. God's wanting to do a lot of good things. And make the announcement that every Tuesday, now every Tuesday at 7:30, we'll, men and women, anybody that wants to participate, if you've got something you want to pray about, we'll be, Brother Kenneth, this is the only way I know to get things done, right here, is we'll be meeting. Preacher, we already come on Sunday, and we already come on Sunday night, and we already here on Wednesday. Why can't, we're setting this night aside for nothing else but to talk to the Lord. And we're coming, and we're going to call out on him, and we're going to ask him to do some special things, Granny, in our lives, in our families' lives, and in our community. We're going to ask God to move, because God is God.
Amen.
And God can still do whatever God wants to do.
Right.
Amen. So all we got to do is get in touch with him. You meet with us, and you help us to pray for things that need to be prayed for. Amen. So remember that. Then also remember, a week from Monday night, we'll be in revival over at New Rock Springs. Me and Brother Mike Farmer will be over there. Our Brother Glenn will get with you. Our choir will be going to sing one night over there at that revival. He just hadn't got back with the preacher yet to make a designated night for us to go. But you pray and come to be with us. We enjoy it. Can't promise you who's going to be preaching, but I promise you, if you'll come in the right mindset, God will feed you. Amen. And that's all we're after, is to be fed by the Master. Amen. So we want you to remember that. Also remember, and I know it's just a few weeks away, and we're working on it, August the 5th and 6th, we'll be in revival here. That's a Friday and Saturday night. We'll be in revival. We've been talking to Brother Zach Watson. He'll be here with us. Our theme is going to be getting started on the right foot, getting back things we need to carry with us into a new year. Our kids are starting a new school year, facing things they've never faced before. Amen. And in November, as we said this morning, we're going to have a new president. Nothing we can do about it. Amen. We're going to have one. And somebody said, what do we need? We need the righteous to be in rule.
Right.
Amen. We need God to take charge. Amen. And so you pray for that. Amen. Pray that God will just help us. Amen. In the things that we're facing right now. So remember that. And pray for that. And anybody else got a prayer request? That's right. Barbara's having surgery at Gwinnett Medical. Tomorrow they're going to be putting a stent in, if I understand it right. I want you to pray for Miss Barbara that Lord will just calm her and help her this time. Also, I want to make this announcement. Miss Sherry has come to us, and Miss Sherry has got with Jason and them and got with some of the youth leaders of our church. And they're going to be making cards to send to our policemen and to our firemen up here at Auburn. She's going to meet with them tomorrow, and we're going to try to, if they would allow us, and if anybody wants to go with us, we're going to try a week from Wednesday night to meet up there, and we're going to pray for them, and if they'll let us, and we're going to ask God to keep them safe and for God to just work in their lives and to help them to make the right decisions. Amen. Preacher, we're just a small little church, and we can't make a difference. All great big churches started out being small little churches that got where they weren't scared to step out on God and work for the Lord. So we're going to ask them, Miss Sherry's going to see, they're going to be filling out cards for these policemen and these firemen. They're going to let the kids do it Wednesday night. And so you see them working and you can help them, you be a help to them, and God will bless you for it. Pray for them, amen. We want them to know that we know that their job is a hard one and one that don't get much pay.
Right. Yes, sir.
Amen. I'm not going to get into it, but I wouldn't be a policeman for what they make. Amen. I'm being honest with you. There's too many chances to get hurt. Amen. But you pray. Smile at me now. I know everybody's worried about what's going to be preached, but I promise you that it's not bad. Amen. And we want to take it in a mindset that God is not punishing us, but God is speaking to us to help us to move forward. Amen. To do things that He wants us to do. Anybody else got a prayer request?
Preacher, I have a prayer request, but I do want all the officers to start praying, because within a month we start into our new officer elections. So everybody start already be praying about what God would have you to do.
Hey, just remember that. All right. How many's got an unspoken request tonight? Amen. All over the house, we're going to go to the Lord in prayer, and we're going to ask Brother Chad, if he will, to lead us to the Lord in prayer, and then we'll go further with our service. Take your Bibles, turn to Joshua chapter number 24. We'll be starting with the first verse, and we'll get right into the message. Thank God for the good singing. Thank God. Paul, I put these words right up under here.
Thank you, sir.
Right there, Joshua chapter number 24. You pray for us tonight that we will get right over into the hands of the Lord and try to deliver the message that God's laid on our heart. I wish that the whole world could hear what God has got to say. Amen. Joshua chapter number 24, it's not because I'm preaching, but because Joshua has a message. I've read this and I've preached it and I've looked at it and But tonight God has took me to a new place and a new time in Joshua's life, and He showed me some things that, and He said to me that it is time in our era that we live that we take some pointers from Joshua. If you'll look with me in Joshua chapter number 24, and we'll read the first verse. It says, "And Joshua gathered all the tribes of Israel to Shechem and called for the elders of Israel and for their heads and for their judges and for their officers, and they presented themselves before God." Notice who is at church tonight. Amen. There's no foreign folks there. Amen. Joshua has called God's people together. He has called the ones that are to be leaders of this nation. He said, "It's time that we have a talk." He said, "It's time that we come together as a family, and we sit down and we go over a few things that will be helpful to you." I believe Joshua knew his time was coming to an end. I believe that he knew that not too long from here. And if you'll read the Bible, before we get out of chapter 24, it says that Joshua died at the age of 110. What a great life. What a great story. What a great effort it took. Amen. Hey, when he took the job, folks probably thought he couldn't do it. Folks probably said, "He ain't a Moses." God didn't need another Moses. God needed a Joshua.
Amen.
Oh, God ain't looking for another Moses, but He's looking for another you.
Bless you.
Amen. Amen. And I feel there's power in this scripture. I feel there's life-changing help. Amen. Let's get right into it, and we'll just do what God said. Skip with me to verse number 15. We'll read this one verse, and God being our helper, we'll bring the message that God's laid on our heart. Amen. And verse number 15, it says, "And if it seem evil unto you to serve the Lord, choose you this day whom ye will serve, whether the gods which your fathers served that were on the other side of the flood, or the gods of the Amorites, in whose land ye dwell. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord." Let's pray. God, as we come to you just one more time, we thank you, Lord, for this day. We thank you for the good reading of your word. And God, we pray that you will open our hearts and let it speak to our mind. And Lord, use our lips, that Lord, that we might be able to speak tonight to your people, to be encouraging, to be uplifting, to vault us into new days with you, that we might be able to have just a new day, that Lord, we can experience things that people thought never could happen. Lord, I love you, and I thank you for being such a good friend. I thank you for walking with us when we didn't even want your hand, Lord. And when we was walking away from us, you was still right there with us. We thank you for it. God, use me tonight. Use me for your honor and your glory. Use me in the way that you would see fit. Help your people. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Notice in verse 15, now we read verse 1 for you to understand who we're talking to. Listen to me, Joshua is talking to the tribe of Israel, amen. And he has told them in verse number 15, he said, if it seem evil unto you, and what he's saying, if it seems unwise, if it seems not the right thing to do, he says, unto you to serve the Lord, choose you this day. There we are having to make another choice in life. Do you know life is full of choices? Do you know that a man, there's choices to be made every day of our life? And some we make good and some we make bad. But there's some more than important than any other choices that we make. Amen. The most important thing in a human's life, in a man and a woman, boy or girl's life, is the choice whether to accept the Lord Jesus Christ as their Savior. And that's what Joshua is telling the people. He said, if it seem evil to you, amen, if you don't believe in him, if you don't know him, then you need to choose you somebody to follow. You need to choose what you're going to go after. You need to choose what you want to be in your life. Amen. I'm so proud that God give us the choice. Amen. Unto you this day whom you will serve, whether the gods which your fathers served that were on the other side of the flood are the gods of the Amorites in whose land you dwell. But as for me, let's stop right there. I want to talk to you tonight. Joshua gives us three things in these last few words of that verse. But as for me, in my house, we will serve the Lord. Amen. Now, I want to talk to you one thing that Joshua does. He says, but as for me, I think it's time that we make church personal again. Yeah. Amen. I mean, it's always been about the other folks. It's always the other person. Notice that Joshua didn't ask the tribe of Israel, but he made a choice for himself. It's time that church gets personal again. Amen. Now, let me tell you something. Amen. Look at here. Personal is something that is affecting or relating to one individual. Amen. His life, his home, his family. Amen. Listen to me tonight. And I want you to understand God wants to have a personal relationship with you. Amen. Preacher, you can't prove that. Amen. Well, ever since the beginning of time, it has been noted that God would come down and he would walk with Adam in the cool of the evening. Amen. They had a relationship. They had a bonding. They had a time spent together, and it was because God made the effort. Amen. Now listen to me today. Joshua has told the children of Israel, we're going to make this personal. We're not going to listen. He told the tribe of Dan, he told the tribe of Judah, he told the family of Joseph, he told all these tribes. Amen. He said these 12 tribes, he said, today as for me, and he's labeling this, I want you to make your own decision. I want you to figure this out on your own. Amen. He said, if it's evil to you to serve a God that's done everything for you, if it's evil for you to worship and to work and to praise a God that has took you out of bondage and took you out of nothing and set you over into everything, he said, then choose you somebody else. I want to stop here to say to you, there is nobody else. Amen. But tonight, God is waiting on you to make it personal. Brother Larry, it's time that we quit looking at everybody else's life. It's time that us as children of God look at our life. Amen. And there's a couple of time things I want to talk to you about being personal. Amen. Number one, it's a personal salvation. Maybe I believe you. I would bet my house that you're saved, that you're sealed, and you're waiting on the Lord. But Granny, only one I'm really sure about is my personal salvation. Amen. I'm the only one. You don't know about me. I wear a suit and tie. I come to church every Sunday. Amen. I try to preach the word. Amen. But only I know about my personal salvation. Listen to me. Joshua has told the people. He said, I'm going to let you know. As for me, I have chose Jesus. Amen. I have chose God to follow the God Jehovah. I want to follow the God that spread the Red Sea. I want to follow the God that fed me when I was hungry. I want to follow the God that watered me when I was thirsty. Amen. I want to follow the God that provided for me when I didn't even deserve it. Amen. That forgave me of my sin. Joshua could have told him, God could have destroyed you. Amen. But I want to follow the God that listened to Moses and told him, that stood in the gap. I want to be tonight I want to make a personal thing to be following the right one. Amen. Amen. Now listen to me. A lot of us take things personal. Amen. Hey, salvation should be the biggest thing that you take personal. Amen. Listen to me. You should make sure. And I want to stress that today, because you can come to church 365 days a year, and if you hadn't made a personal salvation with Jesus Christ, then you're going to die and go to hell. Amen. It don't matter how much you do for the church. It don't matter how much tithes you pay. It don't matter. Salvation is not by works, but salvation is a gift of God. Amen. And you can only receive it by grace through what? Faith. Amen. Amen. So Joshua is saying, I'm going to make a personal statement here. As for me, I'm choosing God. Now listen, that's real easy to say, but listen to what he also said. He said, as for me, I'm making a personal commitment. Amen. I want to talk to you a little bit about your commitment. Yes. Amen. You know you need a personal commitment with God. Amen. You know that it don't work no other way. Amen. Listen to me. I want us to look at our commitment. Amen. Do you know we're committed as long as things are going our way? Do you know we're committed as long as God does what we asked Him to? Do you know we're committed as long as we're happy? But you let things get hard in folks' life and they lose their commitment. Joshua said, as for me, I'm committed today. I'm sold out. I'm going to follow the God that I know to be God. Amen.
Amen.
A personal commitment. Let's investigate what a commitment is. A commitment is where you make a statement that you're going to do something and you tell somebody you're going to do it. I use Brother Glenn. When I tell Brother Glenn, I say, Brother Glenn, I'm going to be at church Monday night to help you clean out the building. I have committed myself to Monday night to be at the church to help Brother Glenn. Amen. Listen to me. You know what? Let me show you something. But what happens? Amen. If something comes up and somebody calls me and says, Brother Frankie, I'm going fishing. Amen. Would you love to go with me? Sometimes I forget my commitment in order to please my flesh. Amen. Do you know we have forgot our commitment that we made to God? Amen. We have forgot that we have committed our life unto Him. Amen. When you got saved, you told God, I want you to save me. And you know what? When you commit to God, amen, you commit for life.
Amen.
Amen. Hey, I got news for you. I'm one of them eternal security things. Amen. I'm one of them people, once God moves in, he don't get evicted. Amen. But I tell you what, hey, I got news for you. God will take the property. Amen.
That's right.
Amen. Amen. Now listen to me tonight. We got to work on our personal commitment to God, to the church, and to our families. Amen. You are committed. When Joshua said, as for me, he was speaking for himself. Amen. Hey, listen to me. I want to tell you something. One of the greatest commitments that I have found was in the book of Genesis, where Noah committed to build an ark. And for 100-some years, nobody helped him, but he stayed committed. He stayed committed, though it never rained. He was committed to doing the work of God. He was committed to doing following the plan of God. He was committed to do God's will in his life.
Right.
Amen. Nobody else showed up to help him. Nobody. Read your Bible and understand it took a great commitment for Noah to get the job done.
Yes, sir.
Amen. Tonight, God wants you to reaffirm your commitment. He wants you to look and see who you are committed to. Are you committed to pleasing the flesh? Are you committed to pleasing Him? Amen. It's going to get quiet before we get through tonight. Amen. Because God is going to talk to us tonight. God is going to bring it to our attention that our commitment is not as great as it used to be.
Yes, sir.
Hey, do you know we live in a day and time folks come to church when they want to?
Yes,
amen. Amen. And if they get a little twang or if they get a little hurt, they don't come back. It's not about sacrificing anymore. You don't sacrifice. Folks don't sacrifice anymore at all. Amen. If we get to a point, a place where we can't handle it, we just quit.
Bless God.
Amen. We give up. Joshua is telling his people, as for me, I'm committed to following a great God. Amen. How is your personal commitment tonight? Don't look around. Amen. Do you know what we do? Amen. This is what we do in church. We look how much anybody else is committed to see how committed we want us to be.
Right.
It don't matter if nobody else comes or not. If you belong to God and God has put you here, then you have committed to God to be here when church is going on.
Amen.
Amen. I'm being honest with you. I'm going to help us to grow tonight because tonight we're going to renew. We're going to renew our commitment to God. Some of us will. Some of us will get very tore up and leave destroyed. Amen. And go home. Amen. And be flabbergasted. Amen. That the preacher could ask me to do more than I'm doing. Amen.
Bless him, Lord.
Bless him, Lord.
Amen. What about all that? Amen. What about our commitment? Hey, and not looking at nobody else's, but looking at Brother Frankie Green, I should have a commitment, being who I am, to studying the Word of God.
Amen.
I have looked at my commitment to God, and I have seen room for improvement. Amen. Listen to me tonight. There's a lot of us think that we do so much. I want you to go home tonight. I want you to turn in your Bible to Romans chapter number 12, where it says to present your bodies holy and acceptable unto God. Amen. Hey, listen to me. And I want you to go through that verse and get down to the last part where it says, and it is a reasonable service.
Right. Bless him.
Bless him.
God don't ask too much out of you. Amen. You know what? Listen to me. And I want us to be practical. But I want us to look at our commitment to God and look how much we ask God to be committed and how much we are committed to Him. We ask God to be there at all times. Amen. We ask God to not never leave us or forsake us, but to help us. Amen. We expect Him to be there. Amen. Look at your commitment. You wake up in the mornings and you have a bad head or something just don't feel right. I'll go another day. There is no more commitment to the house of God, man. It's more about how I feel when I get up.
Bless you, Lord.
Amen. If I feel like going to church, I'll go. If I don't feel like going, I won't go. That's not commitment.
Right.
Amen. When you're committed, you go no matter what.
Bless him.
Now the preacher knows there's times that you're sick. But it's amazing how you can feel so bad at 10 and 11, and by 1, you're ready to go to Golden Corral.
Bless him.
Amen. 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 Don't matter how bad I feel, I got to feed this flesh.
Yes, sir. Bless him.
Amen. You see, tonight you are a great church. But we are working on our personal commitment, my commitment to God, my commitment. When I took this church, I committed to do what God would have me to do. I said, God, I'll do whatever you ask me to do if you will just bless it. If you will just bless it. And I have to tell you that God has blessed us enormously.
Yes,
amen. Amen. And there's such a sweet spirit here. I have preachers that come to preach here that get so excited about their getting to come because there's such a great spirit here, amen, that they feel the freedom of God.
Yes, amen. Bless him.
There's nothing makes a pastor feel better than folks welcoming other folks and folks tell me how loving and how free it is here. What a great thing. But I want to ask you something. Where is your commitment?
Yes,
What, your personal commitment. Are you committed to following God? Amen. Are you committed? Because listen to me, we're going to find out who's committed and who ain't. You look at the shape this world's in, it ain't going to be long before your commitment's going to shine. We're going to find out who you're committed to. Amen. They're already trying to do away with the blood. Amen. They don't want to talk about it no more. But I'm still committed to that blood-bought salvation that took Jesus Christ, died on the cross. Amen. Giving his life that I might have an opportunity. Amen. To have life and have it more abundantly. I'm still committed to the cross. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Are you committed? Or is your commitment grown weak? Used to, church was the, let me tell you something. Church was planned. When you make people make plans, they planned around church. Now people plan church around them.
Amen.
Amen. Churches have revival. I appreciate churches like Ewing's Chapel and churches like we visited at Taylorsville. I've learned that there's more to commitment than just pure mouth. Do you know this talent up at the Taylorsville thing where they hold it for 2 weeks? They are people that take their whole 2 weeks vacation so they can go to camp meeting and help the preacher feed the folks, help the preacher park the car, help the preacher get that.
Just to be a part of it. Yes, sir.
Oh, we're finding out who the committed are. Amen. Now, I'm not saying that these folks are saints. Sure, they have their mistake. But they are committed to what? Getting the word out.
Yes, sir.
Renewing people's lives. Amen. Amen. How's your commitment? Does your commitment stay more on you than you helping somebody else? When's the last time? Listen to me. I'm going to tell you something. How is your commitment to the house of God? Is God still the first? Do you bring your tithes and your offerings into the house? You won't know how blessed we are. See, I'm a nosy preacher and I look at things. Anytime I get to check, there's some elderly folks here that I know get a check a month. Do you know, Granny, they bring their check, they write their tithes out? Their check don't go up, but they still write their check out for their tithes and they give it to Brother Larry. Say amen, Brother Larry. And they are some committed folks, amen. And that's the reason the church is still going like it is. It's because there are folks that are committed to still give to God, amen.
Amen.
A personal commitment. A personal to give back to God what he has given for me. Now, can we pay God for what he's done? No, we can't. But God said, hey, to bring our tithes and our offerings into the storehouse. Hey, I have, and I don't want to pin no flower, but I've seen Granny take her tithes and make sure they get in the offering plate. Yeah. Just gets a little check every month.
Yes, sir.
Amen. But see, and not just her, but there's other folk that are committed. I'm wondering, Joshua said, I'm talking, as for me, I'm making a commitment tonight. That I'm going to put God, and what he's doing is putting God above everything else. Do y'all read that?
Yes, sir.
Do y'all see what he's doing? He's not just blowing in the wind, but he's in front of the judges, he's in front of the rulers, he's in front of all the head folks of the children of Israel. He said, what I'm doing is I am making a commitment to God for me. Amen. I'm going to do my part.
Yes, sir.
Amen. Listen to me tonight. There's no telling what God can do in this church when people commit to do their part.
Yeah, that's right. Amen.
Yeah. Amen. When people commit, notice that Joshua did not commit for his wife. Joshua did not commit for his kids.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. He said, as for me, that's as personal as you get.
Blessing.
Amen. God is not asking you to commit for somebody else, someone that you can't make a commitment for. But God is asking you as an individual, as a person, to make a commitment tonight to him. And watch what God does for you in your life. Somebody said, God is not doing anything. Well, what are you doing? Amen. What are you doing? Hey, I love you. We need you at this church. And we want you to stay. But we want you to look at your commitment.
Yes,
Bless you.
I'm going to go ahead and get this out and get it over. We have things at church, amen, and as long as they don't intercede in nothing else that we do, we might come.
Yeah.
Bless you.
We might come.
Yes, sir.
There is no commitment. Amen. We come when we want to. Ladies, yesterday I watched, had 11 ladies. I was so proud of the ladies. That's great. Amen. A great number. But I want to tell you something. Amen. I want to ask you something. Amen. Listen to me. We've got folks here. Amen. They're not committed to God. They're committed to, I'll give God what I don't need.
Blessing, Lord.
Be real quiet. This is one of them times that being a pastor ain't so much fun. But God has asked me tonight to ask you to make a personal commitment, not to be resaved, but to reaffirm your commitment to God. Reaffirm to say, God, I'm sorry for the way that I have been treating you. And do some of us feel like we have been putting God as second best?
Yes, sir.
Blessing.
As second best. God, I'll give you what I don't want. I'll give you what I don't need. Amen. Joshua's making it personal, and he is making a personal commitment. Amen. Do you know the reason so many people that struggle? Amen. And I'm not after you. This is the givingest church that I've ever seen. I had brother preachers that come, and they tell me, and you know what, Brother Carl Partain, he told me one time, he said, the reason that God is blessing your church so much is because you take care of God's people. We got seven missionaries that we support. Amen. Preachers that come in for revival, we take care of their rooms, we take care of the meal, we take care. I'm telling you, folks, God will take care of you if you commit to doing what He asks you to do.
Amen.
Amen. Listen to me. Let the preacher have. There's some of you here, amen, that don't pay tithes. There's some of you here that say that your family comes first. That you ought to take care of your family, but the best way of taking care of your family is putting God first.
Amen.
Well, my wife will get mad, and you'll be surprised. You see that woman sitting over there? She keeps the money at our house. I'll never forget, before we ever come over here, God spoke to me when we was at Hickory Grove, and He said, listen to me, brother, you're going to have to pay your tithe. Hey, man, you're going to preach it, you got to live it. Amen. You tell folks they ought to do what God asked them to do, and I said, Lord, I can't go to her. I'll just pay them under the table. I mean it. When I got my check, I knew what she'd make, and I said, I'll just put it in the church plate. Amen. Won't worry about it. There's some of y'all, listen to me. Look at me. There's some of you are looking at me like I am talking to a block wall. Amen. But I am trying to get you to reaffirm that you believe that God can do all things.
Amen.
Listen to me. I'm going to be honest with you. Amen. If we don't commit, then we're not going to get to see things happen in our life. Amen. Joshua could have walked away that day and not ever worried. But he said, there's a need that I commit to God. Amen. Commit. Will you commit to God? Not only with that part, but would you commit to Him being first in your life?
Bless Him.
Amen. Amen. I'm going to tell you something. How many here hold a job? Don't raise your hand. But how many here, if you don't feel like it, still going to work in the morning? I was married to the workaholic. I'm a construction worker. We're Brother Gray. We like a rainy day, don't we, Brother Gray? Amen. God help the rain. Amen. They've been days. We pray for it. Amen. Amen. Ain't that right, Brother Larry? Amen. Hey, listen to me. But listen to me. There are folks today that are so committed to their job. My wife, I don't know how many years, she could be feeling bad. I mean, dizzy-headed, worried about her driving, and she would still get up and get dressed and go to the schoolhouse.
Amen.
And have 100-some sick days. And I look at her and shake my head. What? Ain't that, am I telling the truth? Yes, you was. I'll say amen to it. Amen. But Granny, she was committed. She was committed to being at her job and doing what she was supposed to do. And I'm going to tell you, there's a bunch of you that are committed to your job. All I'm asking you to do is to be committed to God like you are to your job.
Amen. Blessing.
Oh, me. Do you know some of us can just get to feeling bad? I'm dizzy. How are you doing? Amen. Hey, but listen, we're still smiling. But we're talking about a commitment. A commitment. And if we committed to God like we do our jobs, they would be more of the benefits of God being showered down upon us. Hey, God is wanting to do something real here, but He's going to need some commitments. He's going to need some commitments that you're going to put Him first in your life. Amen. Amen. Listen, Joshua made a personal commitment. As for me, I'm going to follow the Lord. Hey, listen to me. And then Joshua was practical. We need some practical Christians in the house. Practical. Do you know what that is? Now listen to me. A picture. Now this is a redneck. This is my definition. This, hey, practical. It's nothing more than common sense. I want to read you something. Amen. Listen to me. I want to show you something. Amen. Listen to me. Practical. Using common sense, mindful of the results. Listen to me. Joshua is being very practical here when he makes a commitment to God because he knows God won't let him down. He is being very practical, using a lot of common sense. He said, let's look at this situation. Let's look at this picture. I'm living in the lands of the Amorites. I'm living in a place that I did not build. I'm eating out of fields that I did not plant. I'm living in a place that God did my fighting for.
Yep, that's right.
Now, is that not being practical? Some of you need to be practical tonight, and it will help you to make a commitment. You are what you are by the grace of God. Paul said that in the book of Corinthians. Amen. In the 15th chapter, I believe it was. He said, I am what I am. Let's be practical. You ain't where you are because you're so great. It's because God has shined down upon you. God's been good to me. Amen. Ain't that right? Let's be practical. Zach, you didn't get to where you got without His help. Amen. Amen. Listen to me. Hey, you can't get folks to be practical. They're always looking for something that's a little different or a little out of the way. Let's be practical. If you hope to have something good in this life, the Bible says, what profit a man if he gains the whole world and loses his soul? And I want you to read the book of Ecclesiastes sometime. It talks about everything that is in vain. When's the last time you got practical? Use some common sense. Putting God first means that God will add to you. Seek ye first the kingdom of heaven and His righteousness. And then all these other things shall be. Shall what? But do what? Seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, His will. Make that commitment and let God do what's left in your life. Do you know the reason you don't have more than you have is because you haven't sold out totally committed to God? There's always somewhere else that's something better. There's always, let's be practical, there is nothing better than God.
Amen.
Amen. What Joshua was saying, there's nobody like God. Amen. He loved us when we wouldn't love Him. He delivered us when we didn't deserve it.
Yes, sir.
Amen. Amen. Y'all don't remember the story? Joshua is remembering how practical it is. Practical is using common. When I think of common sense, I think of Elijah Craig. Just look at this young man. That's common sense thrown all over it right there. Never gets excited too much. Never. But he is always looking for some reasonable answer for why something happened. Why did this take place? What is reasonable about this? This was just not by the Big Bang Theory. This was not just happening. But let's get practical. Let's look and see why this. You want to, Elijah? Let's see why this had really happened. Because God loved them so much that He heard their prayer after 400 years, that He had a baby that He saved, that He sent into the desert, that He called up on the mountain, that He sent back to Egypt, that He gave the power to tell Pharaoh to set my people free. Let's be practical tonight. The reason that we're here is because God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in Him would not perish but have what? Everlasting life. You're not here because you're so great. You're not here because of who you are. You are here because God has been good to you. And we need to be practical, amen. And the practical and the common sense thing to do is turn to God, amen. Amen. Listen to me. I want to tell you what, we're living in a world today, amen, to where I am worried for our future. Now, I'm not so worried. I'm 57, fixing to be 58. Or I'm 56. I don't know how old I am, but I'm not. Hey, how old are you?
I'm 57, going on 58.
I'm 56, going on 57. I have to check Larry's license. Amen. But let's look at me. What's practical for me? God has brought me this far. Let's use common sense. God's able to take me the rest of the way.
Amen, sir.
Huh? Hey, and what Joshua was doing is, let's look at this thing practically. Let's look at it with common sense. God has been able to deliver us through everything that we have went through.
Bless you.
And if we would break this down, He would probably say, listen, boys, remember that time? Oh, you know, we didn't have water. And He let Moses speak to the rock.
Yeah.
Amen. Amen. Remember that time when you were hungry and He let manna fall from heaven?
Yes, sir.
Amen. Listen to me tonight. Do you get the picture? All Joshua was doing is being practical. He's doing nothing great. He's doing what is reasonable. He is telling God, I'll accept you for who you are. Amen.
Amen.
He says, I trust you, God. I'm making a commitment. And I'm being practical. I'm going with the God that's able to deliver.
Yes, sir.
Huh?
Yes,
we heard that this morning, and I know I didn't do a real good job, but God is pressing the point that He is still able to deliver.
Yes, sir.
Bless you. Amen. God didn't quit being God in the 2000th century. God didn't quit being God.
Right.
God didn't quit being in charge of everything. Amen. I'm being honest. We act like God has lost all power. But God still has the power to say rain and it rains. And God,
amen.
Hey, some of y'all believe in Mother Nature, don't you?
Bless Him.
I tell you who it is. It's Father God that controls
it. Amen.
If you believe the Word of God, you know that's a fact. Because God said rain and it rained for 40 days. And after the 40th day, God turned it off.
Bless Him.
There ain't nobody like my God.
Amen.
Hey, man, we need to be practical. We need to use common sense. There's nobody like the God that we serve. Amen. Say
amen.
Get excited because your God's real.
Bless you. Amen.
We act like our God is not capable of hearing us. Let's be practical. He hears us.
Bless Him.
Amen. Listen to me. I'm just trying to stress the point to where you make a personal commitment, that you go back to putting God first in your life. Now listen to me. This does not mean that when I put God first that I throw my family away. No, that ain't what the preacher is saying. Amen. Hey, but listen to me. There is a certain thing of using your family as a stumbling block.
Mm-hmm.
Amen. I love these women that's got these husbands. They still come to church, Miss McDaniel, but them husbands don't come. But that don't stop them from being committed to God.
Bless
Him.
Bless
Him.
That's right.
Bless Him. Amen. Y'all worried about that commitment and y'all not being practical. Amen.
Bless Him, Lord.
I'd rather commit to a God that I know without a shadow of a doubt is able to take care of me.
Yeah.
Amen.
Bless him.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Let's be practical, Brother Larry. God is the reason that we have been blessed.
Yes, sir.
Me and you, me and Larry talking. Larry, I don't have favorites, but Larry, me and him, he was here when I first come. Me and Larry, back when we first got here, construction business and the roofing business was not good. Not at all. Me and him couldn't rub two nickels together, hardly, Brother Grady, at that time. Amen. And God did that for a reason. Amen. Because, Brother Dean, we can't say we put this church back on the map. Let's be practical. We didn't even have work. Amen. All we can say is that we come together and committed to God, and God did the rest. Amen.
Amen.
Bless him.
But, Brother Larry, with things being better than it was, amen, God has been good to us. Let's be practical.
Yes. Yeah, yeah.
Marcia, you remember when you lived in the trailer over there in the trailer park, you didn't have room to walk, and there was neighbors all around you, and you didn't have a yard, and you didn't have nowhere. Now God has took you out from over there, and he's put you in a great big house. Amen. And he's got a backyard. David's got a workshop. David's got things going on. Amen. Do y'all get a hold to this?
Amen.
It ain't because they work so hard. It's because it's been practical, because listen to me, God has been good. Amen.
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 Bless him, Lord.
Amen.
Bless him.
Amen. I just want folks to use a little common sense. Serving God is not something that we ought to even have to think about. But serving God is something that we should just, as easy as getting out of church.
Bless him.
Because he has been so good. And Joshua has told the folks, he said, you look at your life. He said, if it seemed evil to you to commit to a God that has done all this for you, then choose you who you want to follow. And I'm telling you what, I have followed the wrong people before, ain't you?
Yes, sir.
There's times in my life that I have listened to the wrong one. I'm serious, Brother Doug. There's times that old devil has talked to me that he has led me astray.
Yes, sir. Yeah.
And let's be real sensible about this. Amen. God could have killed me.
Yeah.
God could have got rid of me. But he loved me enough.
Right.
I'm here today not because I'm so great, but because of the love and the mercies of God.
Amen.
But church, I'm coming to you tonight, and I am asking you, we're not going to sign any papers, and we're not going to pass around any books and ask you to do anything, but I am asking you to reaffirm your commitment to God.
Bless him.
Amen. To come. Now watch it. I don't think I'm being very vulgar or ugly, but when you make a commitment to God, you can look for wind, hell, or high water.
Yeah.
The devil's coming after you. To see how real your commitment is.
Bless him. Bless him.
And I'm going to be honest with you. Let's be practical. I'd rather commit to someone that I know that had the power to say, peace, be still, and the winds and the waves obey his blessing.
Amen.
Amen. God is saying that Joshua is being, he is making it personal. Hey, I'm going to tell you how personal it is. He's taking it home with him. Because he says, as for me and my house, listen to what he says, and my house. And once he says my house, he says, we.
Yeah.
He is committing. And can I help you moms and daddies right now? How old are you, Zach? Do you think I can make him do anything now? Be hard. I got a bat at home. That'd be the only way I'd try to stop him. I would not fight fair. Not with him. No, sir. Why are you saying this, preacher? Because Joshua is saying, it's for the things that I can control. The things that go on at my house. Now, you've got children that's over the age of adulthood that are on their own, that are doing their own thing. God said, bring your children up in the admiration of the Lord. There's a lot of us as our children are not children anymore. That'll always be mama's baby, but he ain't a child no more. That's a man. Amen?
Yes, sir.
And he's got a job, and he pays his bills, and he does what man's supposed to do.
Blessing.
But as long as he lives at Daddy's house, as long as he's there, he's going to go to church.
Blessing.
He's going to do what's right. Well, let me tell you, he's going to church. That's all I can say. That's all I can tell you. That's all I can say. I can't tell you he's going to do nothing else. I'm going to tell you, Brother Grady, when I leave the house, he's going to leave the house.
Blessing.
Laying in there on Sunday morning, they ain't going to get it.
Blessing.
He expects me to keep a roof over his head, lights on. Amen. Hey, and that's what Joshua is committing to. As much as I can handle, as much as I can, that is under my control, I am going to commit to doing what I can for God.
Bless.
And I'm saying this to help you. God don't hold your daddy and mama accountable for you no more, baby. He looking at you.
Bless.
And you're going to give an account. Now, they're going to give an account on how they brought you up. But you're going to give an account on how you live now.
Blessing.
Amen. See, we like to think as young folks that God don't look for a commitment from us, but yes, he does. And the reason you haven't went any further in your life is because you're wondering and you don't know who to commit to.
Blessing.
Amen. You don't know who to commit to. But if we did a survey of the people that thought the world had what they needed, they will come to a realization that the world did not have. This is hard preaching.
Blessing.
This is hard preaching. But let me tell you what God does with hard preaching. He breaks ground in people's life.
Yes,
amen. There's a bunch of folks don't know nothing about a field. And I'm not a big hand at it. Amen. What I was made done, I was made do. But the ground would be so hard, and there would be lumps in it, and my daddy would take a tractor, and he would break that ground up, and then he would till it. That's a bunch of little turning wheels, amen, that he would run back and forth over that hard ground until he broke it up and got it ready to be planted. God wants to do things in your life, but there's a lot of ground he's got to break up. He's got to get rid of a lot of hard things in your life that you won't turn loose of and that you won't commit to let go. And he's working on you. Amen. And until you learn to do it, ain't nothing going to be planted at your house.
Blessing.
Amen. 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 Now Joshua is just being practical. And you know what? You read, I'm going to hurt you. You read, he is persistent. Which means he continues to do what he said he would. Can I tell you that we have made a commitment here at this church to serve God. At this church, we ought to be persistent in what we believe.
Certainly.
Yes, sir.
Amen. You know the world is not trying to change our name, but it's trying to change our faith.
Right.
Have y'all caught on yet?
Yeah.
Oh, they're not trying to say there is no God anymore. They're trying to change on how you believe.
Yeah.
They're working on your belief. Do you know today used to be separation? The church preached separation. Come ye out of the world, be ye a separated folk.
Right.
Brother Dale, you know what preachers preach today? Moderation.
Yeah.
Just do a little bit, it won't hurt you. Just do a little bit. Moderation has messed more folks up in the day that we live than anything else. Go on and have a little drink.
Yes, sir.
Go on and have a little smoke.
Right.
Go on and take a little pill.
Bless him, Lord.
Bless
him. Amen. The church used to preach, come ye out, be ye a separated folks. Amen.
Right.
Taste not, handle not the unclean things of the world.
Right. Bless him, Lord.
You remember them days, don't you, Granny?
Bless
him. Amen. And God would bless folks, and God still is blessing folks that keep their commitment unto him.
Bless him. Bless him, Lord.
The Bible teaches us not to be blown away around with every wind and doctrine. But today, do you know there are so many folks, there's so many pastors and so many preachers that take the stand and preach, just do anything and live any way? God's a loving God.
Yeah.
We need to stay persistent in what we believe. That means to be continuing to trust our God to do what's right. He's brought you this far. He'll take you the rest of the way.
Yes, sir.
Is that not right? Smile at me, y'all. Smile. This might be hard to swallow, but this is the kind of stuff that helps me and you to grow as Christians. Listen to me. We're wanting to see things happen around our church. We're wanting to see your loved ones. We're wanting to see families built. I'm being honest. See, I'm not Martin Luther King, but I got a dream.
Bless the Lord.
You see these young men, that they won't go nowhere else, but they'll go out and they'll find them wise, godly women, and they will bring them back into the church, and they will help us to fill this place.
Yes.
Amen.
That's right.
Hey, that's right, Brother Kim. Amen. Hey, listen to me. And I, you see these young ladies? I'm praying that they find godly men.
Amen.
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Amen. Godly men. Preacher, I'm just going to take anybody I can get. That's what's wrong. The world is sat there. They're just settling for anybody.
Bless the Lord.
Have you ever counseled young folks that are getting married? Amen. I mean, set them down in a room. First question I ask, why y'all doing it?
Listen, listen.
Why are y'all doing this? I want to see what they say. And some of them say, I had one boy come to my house. He wanted to get married. I'll never forget him. I'll never mention his name. But I said, why are you doing this? And he said, because I love, sir. I thought that marriage would last forever. It lasted about 6 months. Amen. I've struck out before. I've had some that I married last 7 days. I asked them the same question. Why are you doing this? Oh, because I'm in love with her and I want to spend the rest of my life with her. I just want to be around her all the time. Boy, that didn't last long. Do you know the answer that I look for, that I hardly ever hear, Miss Berkeley, is that we have been together and we have prayed about this and we feel like God has joined us together and we want to put this marriage together so that we might be able to work for God.
Bless him.
Listen to me. How many times do you remember these little young folks? How many remember Will Hill, our missionary in Japan? Brought that little woman in here, didn't have a baby. Going to take her over to Japan. Boy, they had to be some praying going on there. But did you know, I got a letter from them the other day, and they are doing good. Their commitment is stronger than ever. She is learning the language. When you wait and you get you somebody that is committed like you are, then you and him will be able to walk the road together and agree.
That's right.
Bless him, Lord.
Bless.
Not all the time, but you will. Let's be practical. Then let's be persistent. God knows what he's doing. Let's trust God in our lives. Let's be persistent. Elijah, God's got a plan for you. He called you into the ministry. He has called you to carry his word. He has called you to be a man that he can use in his work. Amen? I believe that. I felt the Lord when you preach. Amen? I'll sign your ordination papers when it's time. I'm serious. I believe in you. I believe that God's got his hand on your life. But we need to be persistent. God needs to be first in your life. Above everything else, Elijah, you need to put God first. And if you do, God will take you to heights that you never dreamed of.
Bless him, Lord.
You'd be surprised what God... There's been ugly men get pretty women. Ain't God good? Amen. Amen. You see what I'm saying? That's what I'm talking about. We have got to learn to get our priorities right. Amen. It ain't about what Frankie Green wants. It ain't about the Green family. But it's about the family of God. If God's for it, then I ought to get with it.
Amen.
Yes, sir.
You know what? And I'm going to put this. So being supported is one of the best tools that a Christian can use to help in the work of God. Being supported. Miss Sherry come to me in Petey. She said, I got something I want us to do. And we met with her and she said, I want to go and pray for our policemen and our firemen. I want to go pray for them. A lot of folks, that's far-fetched. Why do that? Yeah. Amen. To let them know that there's somebody praying for them.
Yeah.
I'm asking you. Not too long, and I don't want to open the door of what's coming down the road in the future. But I have talked with the deacons, and we have made plans, and we are going to bring it in front of the church before too long, that when we get $50,000 into our building fund, we are going to start work on a brand new fellowship hall. I said we were going to bring it before the church. If you say no, we won't do it, we'll just sit on it. And then I'll listen to you grumble about eating in that little place out there.
Listen, Lord.
Listen to me. I'll be with you no matter where we meet or what we do. Amen. But what God has showed me is that, preacher, we'll never get there.
Bless you.
We'll never get there. And I'm not our financial advisor, but while you were sleeping,
yes, sir.
We are close to $40,000 in our building fund right now. Yes.
Blessing.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Blessing, Lord.
Unaware we
were there. Look out, preacher. And part of the next 6 months is in November, the third Sunday after the Sunday after we feed the hungry, we're going to have a thank you offering. We're going to bring our tithes and our offerings in and give thanks, not asking him for nothing in return, but giving him them, thanking him for what he has done for us this year.
Yes, sir.
Amen.
In December, we're going to have a stob driving day where we're going to break ground. We're going to drive stobs in the ground.
Bless you, Lord.
I have already been told that Bexar County will be hard to deal with. I've already been told there will be complications. I've already been told it can't be done. I've already been told we'll never pay it off. I've already been told that we'll make a flop out of it. But God said if we raise the money, we can do it, and he would help us. And I'm going to tell the devil just to back up, and I'm going to trust God, and I'm going to make a commitment that if God will help us, we'll get the job done.
Bless him.
Bless him.
Amen.
Bless him.
He makes a commitment from God's people. Driving the stops in the ground is exciting, but making a $1,000 payment is very not exciting.
Bless him, Lord. Bless him, Lord.
But I want to give you something. When we commit to do something for God, we committed to pay the parking lot $30,000 we owed. Do you know before 6 months, before a year was out, that note was paid off?
Yes, sir.
Amen. Somebody want to shout tonight. Amen.
Yes.
We better reaffirm our commitment to God because God has not let us down. Let's be practical. Every time we step out of the boat, we have not sunk, but we have been able by the walk on water. Amen.
Yes,
sir.
Blessing.
Touch me, Lord. Amen. But it starts with a reaffirmed commitment. Reaffirmed commitment. God, I'm going to let you know. I want to do my part. And if you're struggling, the best way to get back on top of things is to start over putting God first in your life.
Amen.
Amen. Preacher, I can't afford to do it. You can't afford not to do it.
That's right.
Amen.
Amen. Glenn, get a song. I've probably worried folks as much tonight. But let's get personal for a minute. Don't look at nobody else. Don't look at nobody. Okay? I want you to look at yourself as you were looking in the mirror and say, in this last 6 months, have I been committed to God like I'm supposed to be? There was so much that I wanted to talk to you, but I want to do it in a very calm. You know, are you committed to the visitation program? Are you committed to running a van? Do you know that after God paid that van off, we ain't run it one or two times since then?
Bless him.
Oh me, we ain't got nowhere to go.
Touch me.
touching, Lord.
We ought to run it just to let folks know that it's running.
Blessing, Lord.
Blessing.
I'm sorry. You wanted me to, I wanted to make you happy tonight. I wanted to let you know about the good things, but it don't come unless we get committed.
That's right.
Amen.
Church one time, they had a bus. And they had a little place that they run it. And they didn't pick up nobody for months and months, but they kept running the little bus through the area. Wasn't a trailer park like a housing authority. They would just ride through like an ice cream truck does where anybody buys anything or not. He rides through every evening hoping that there'll be somebody that'll want something off his truck. All of a sudden, a little boy come out of the house. Can I go with you? Can I go with you? Bus driver stopped and he opened his door. Ricky Fields used to go to this church. I can't think of the name of it, but you know Chris.
Greater Heights.
Can I go with you? Can I go with you? And all of a sudden, he got on the bus. And he stuck and went to church. The next Sunday, all his family, his sisters. Before long, there were more folks coming out of the projects to go to church. Now, they have 8 buses.
Bless them.
But it comes from somebody being committed. From somebody saying, God, I ain't picked up nobody in a long time. But because you said go, I'm going to go. Because you said, just go through there just one more time. Peter was committed not to anything else, but he said, Jesus, upon your word, I'm going to cast the net out just one more time. Oh, what feeling he got when he went to draw it. Tonight, God is wanting us to reaffirm some commitments. He's wanting it to be personal between you and him. He's wanting you to get hurt. He's wanting you, Brother Zach, to commit your life to him. To sell out. You're a man of God. You ought to be sold out to the word. Listen, son, there's so much that your daddy hadn't done because he wasn't very committed. He wasn't as committed to that word like he should. I learned at a very late age, Granny, what it takes to be a good preacher. And I don't put myself in the class of a good preacher. But to want to be able to preach the word is to be committed to studying that word. Amen. I want to be committed. I want to be able to do the things that God wants me to do while we stand, while we sing. It's going to take a commitment.
Are you looking for a place to worship God in spirit and in truth? Hello, I'm Frankie Green, pastor of Trinity Baptist Church in Auburn, Georgia. We would like to invite you to be in our service with us. Sunday school starts at 10, with morning worship at 11. Sunday evening worship begins at 6, and Wednesday night prayer service at 7. We are a King James Bible-believing, fundamental, independent Baptist church reaching out to those who need a special touch from God. For more information, you can visit us at TrinityBaptistAuburn.com or on Facebook at Trinity Baptist Church, Auburn. We welcome you to Trinity Baptist Church, where you will become part of a family.